I am Mr. Drew. In this video, we are going to do four examples of finding missing lengths, missing sides of a right triangle. Now, if you're given a right triangle and you know two sides and you're missing the length of the third side, whether that's a leg like this example or a hypotenuse like my first example is going to be, you can solve those using the Pythagorean Theorem. Now, if it is, say, if I only know one side of a right triangle and the other two sides are unknown, then I'm going to have some information about one of these acute angles in the corner and do some functions called trig functions, sine, cosine, and tangent. Those are beyond the scope of this lesson, but just to let you know, you can't always use Pythagorean Theorem when you have a right triangle. If you have less information or different information, you'll have to find some other way to find that missing information. But we are going to have two sides and be looking for a third. So, Pythagorean Theorem says we've got a right triangle again, and of course, all triangles have three sides. They have two legs, well, a right triangle will have two legs. The two sides that we call legs are the two sides that come together to make the right angle, or the 90 degree angle. And then the side that is opposite that 90 degree angle, that's not helping to create that 90 degree angle, that is going to be your hypotenuse, and it will be the longest side of your triangle. So if you do your math, and you know this is maybe a 3 and a length of 4, if your hypotenuse is not longer than either 3 or 4, it would be a 3, 4, 5 triangle, by the way. We'll be able to figure that out by the end of this video. If your hypotenuse, the side opposite the right angle, is not the longest measurement, then you have made a mistake somewhere. The formula for the Pythagorean Theorem is, so I've seen this written, you probably won't see it like this, but leg squared plus leg squared equals hypotenuse squared. In other words, just make sure that the longest side of your triangle, the hypotenuse, the side opposite 90 degrees or the right angle, is the side that is by itself. What you will see most of the time in textbooks, or all the time really, is a squared plus b squared equals c squared. The two sides that have something in common, the two sides that help to make the right angle, the 90 degree angle, those two sides are always together in the equation. And the hypotenuse, again, the longest side, is always the value that is by itself. Whether you know it or not, the hypotenuse has to be the value that's over to the right-hand side of your equation by itself. Okay, we're going to do four examples, and with increasing difficulties we go. And I'm going to do another video with some three more advanced examples that have a little bit of algebra involved in them. So we've got this right triangle because of the corner, and we have a leg of 5. This is certainly not drawn to scale. A leg measured is drawn with a length of 5, and the other leg a length of 12. You should never really trust a diagram in geometry, and most of the time when you take standardized tests like the SATs, it would say not drawn to scale. If I wanted to attempt to make this look a little better, of course, 5 is much shorter than 12. So maybe the diagram should look something like that. Well, we know the two sides that make the right angle, and we're looking for the hypotenuse. I think I had a C there before, but it doesn't really matter what the letter is. Unless, of course, you're using the A, B, C values that are in the Pythagorean Theorem, because A and B are marked off as the legs. Let's put that C back in there. And C is the hypotenuse, but a variable is just a number that or a letter that represents an unknown numerical value, and it really doesn't matter, you know, whether you call it A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. Most of your problems are going to be in terms of X. And again, Pythagorean Theorem is A squared plus B squared equals C squared, but that's why I'm giving you this more generic formula here, where it's just, you know, take a leg and square it, add it to another leg squared, and set it equal to the hypotenuse squared to reinforce, you know, a variable is just a variable. It's what that number it's what that variable represents numerically that's important. So 5 squared plus 12 squared, the two sides that are helping to make the right angle together on the same side of the equation, equals c squared. Now 5 squared is 25. 12 squared is 144. Now 5 squared is 5 times 5, not 5 times 2. That would be 2 times 5 if it were. 5 squared is 5 times 5, which is 25. 12 squared is 12 times 12, this is 144, and that is equal to c squared. This comes out to be 169 when you add them. And you get rid of a power of 2, an exponent of 2, by square rooting both sides of your equation, and you get c is equal to 13. Now, when you square root a number, there is a positive and a negative answer. If this were not a word problem or an application problem, and we were not talking about, you know, actual measurements, then the square root of 169 would be plus or minus or positive negative 13. But you can't have a negative difference. That'd be kind of like you taking a tape measure, you know, that you pull out of a spool. You don't push that tape measure back inside the spool and have a negative measurement. You know, you only pull it out and you have that positive measurement. So the hypotenuse here is 13, and that side opposite the right angle is longer than my other two sides, the two sides that are helping to make the right angle, my two legs. So here we have another problem. The variable is on one of the legs, and a lot of students incorrectly will write 7 squared, let me go back to the orange chalk here, 7 squared plus 9 squared equals x squared. A lot of students want to keep the variable alone for all the problems. No. The hypotenuse, the side opposite the 90 degree angle, has to be the side that is left alone. The two sides that help make the right angle must stay together on the same side of the equation. So we have x squared, one leg, plus the other leg squared, 7 squared, equals the hypotenuse squared, which is 9 squared. This is x squared plus 49 equals 81. We're going to subtract both sides by 49, get x squared is equal to, let's see here, 81 minus 40 is 41, and 41 minus 9 is 32. Okay, like I said, these are going to be coming in just ever-increasing difficulty as we go through here. We're going to square root both sides of the equation and get x is equal to the square root of 32. Now, some teachers, and sometimes I'm guilty of it too, depending on the level of class, but, you know, okay, well, just put in a calculator and get a decimal. You need to be comfortable using square roots or just radicals in general and simplifying them, especially if you're in geometry going in algebra 2. You will need to understand how to reduce a radical. So I want to make this smaller and get an exact value answer, not a decimal. If I can reduce this square root of 32, I can reduce it if there is a perfect square in 32. Now, a perfect square is like 2 times 2 is 4. 4 does go into 32, but so will a bigger one. 3. 3 times 3 is 9. 9 is the next perfect, I don't know why I'm doing 7, but 9 is the next perfect size, perfect square, but 9 doesn't go into 32. So 4 squared, or 16, is a perfect square, and 16 does go into 32. 32 divided by 16 is 2. So I'm factoring this in such a way that one of my factors is a perfect square. And then the square root of 16 is 4. And thus, this missing leg has a length of 4, square root of 2 units. That would be considered an exact value answer, because if you put in the square root of 2 into your calculator, you will get a decimal that runs off the screen, and it doesn't stop at the end of that screen. It actually goes on forever and ever and ever. So that decimal is a rounded off value, and thus will be an approximate answer. This is the exact solution. I got two more examples. Thank you very much for watching. I hope this is helping. For our next example, we have the variable on the hypotenuse. Students do generally tend to get these correct more often with the variable on the hypotenuse when they're first learning the process, but I have the 4 square root of 3 here, and again, we're not just going to make decimals here. I want to make sure that you understand how to deal with square roots, so we're going to increase the difficulty a little bit by having the radical in the problem in the first place. A squared plus b squared equals c squared, or the two sides that help to make the leg, or excuse me, the two legs that help to make the right angle stay together on the same side of the equation. So, we've got 4 square root of 3 squared plus 4 squared equals x squared. The hypotenuse squared. Okay, so 4 square root of 3 squared is 4 square root of 3 times 4 square root of 3. We want to put the coefficients together, 4 times 4, which is going to be 16, and we want to put the square roots together separately. The square root of 3 times the square root of 3 is the square root of 9, and the square root of 9 is 3. When you multiply square roots together, and they have exactly the same value on the inside of the square root symbol, it will cancel out, like I just said. Square root of 3 times square root of 3 is 9, which comes right back down to 3. Now, the 4 and the square root of 3 are touching, the 4 and the square root of 3 are touching, so when you do the 4 times 4 and get 16, when you do the square root of 3 times square root of 3 and get 3, please remember that you are multiplying those, you know, not, I don't know, whatever else students come up with sometimes. So 16 times 3, 10 times 3 is 30, 6 times 3 is 18, so it's 48. 4 squared is 16. 48, 58, 58 and 6 is 64. We're going to square root both sides of the equation and get a final answer of 8. And we got one more example. Last example. We got a right triangle. We've got a missing leg. We have another leg, which is 2.5. We have a hypotenuse, which is 3 2/3. And yes, there's fractions in here. So we're going to leave those in there. We're going to deal with them. We're going to make them improper fractions so they're more easier to work with, find common denominators, all that good, exciting stuff. Well, we're finding x. So the two sides that make the right angle, the two legs that make the right angle, again, stay together. So we have 2 1/2 squared plus x squared is equal to the hypotenuse, which needs to be squared. You might notice that every time I do substitution, I use parentheses. All these values are positive, so really at this point it's just a habit. But if you do substitution with, say, algebraic expressions where there's more than one term, or if you're substituting in negative values, the parentheses are very, very important. You do need to basically use parentheses every time you do substitution. These are mixed fractions, and while it is possible to work with them, it's not very nice. So we're going to make these improper fractions. We're going to do the denominator times this whole number out here, so 2 times 2 is 4, and then add on the numerator. So 2 times 2 is 4, plus 1 is 5. So we have 5 over 2 squared plus x squared equals 3 times 3 is 9, and 3 times 3 is 9 plus 2 is 11 over 3 squared. We're going to take this fraction and square it. That means that we're going to do 5 over 2 times 5 over 2. When you multiply fractions, you go straight across. Or when you square a fraction, you square both the top numerator and the denominator. So 5 times 5 is 25. And 2 times 2 is 4, or 2 squared is 4. Plus x squared is equal to 11 squared, which is 11 times 11, which is 121. 3 squared, which is 9. We need to take this 25 over 4 and move it over to the other side. So we're going to subtract this side by 25 over 4. I'm going to cancel this out and erase it in just a second. And I'm going to bring that minus 25 over 4 over here. I'm leaving some room because, of course, we need common denominators to add or subtract fractions. The lowest common multiple between 9 and 4. 9, I'm going to take the either number, whatever. 9, 18, 4 doesn't go into 9, 4 doesn't go into 18, 9, 18, 27, 4 does not go into 27, 36. So the lowest common multiple between these numbers is 36. So to get the 9 to be equal to 36, we're going to multiply it by 4. To get the 4 to equal 36, we're going to multiply it by 9. It seems like we're just sort of swapping the denominators and multiplying them to the numerator and denominator. And you actually can do that. The reason why I'm having to do that here is because 4 and 9 don't have any common factors in them. So that is, you know, all we're left with, and the numbers just have to be a little bit big. So So let me get this out of the way, because it's going to cancel out. And I need the room. So we have x squared is equal to 121 times 4 is 484. Minus, I'm going to write one big fraction because I already have my common denominator of 36. Let's see here, 25 times 9. Now I can try and do that, but it's a quarter, right? So if you have 4 quarters, that's a dollar or 100 cents. If you have 8 quarters, that's $2 or 200 cents plus an additional quarter. So 225, 25 times 9 is 225. Now it's over 36. And 484 minus 225. Well, 484 minus 200 is 284. Minus 20 is 264. Minus 5, 264 minus 5. 264 minus 5. Should be 259. Let me double check. Yes, 259. So x squared is equal to 259 over 36. We're going to square root both sides. And we're going to get x is equal to the square root of 259 over, now, 36. The square root of 36 is 6. And as I'm finishing this up, I'm realizing I didn't look to see if there was any perfect squares in 259. So let me pause this. I'm going to take 259 divided by 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49. Run through all the perfect squares and see if they're already in that value, and thus, you know, have that be reducible. Let me double check. Be with you in just a second. Maybe you should do the same. Well, I checked. That's as simple as the answer gets. There are no perfect squares in 259. And so, whatever, that's the answer. If your teacher's going to be happy with decimals, it's okay to just type all this in there and get a decimal form, but I'm going to leave that in exact form and call it a day. I'm going to do one more video after this. This is, again, Pythagorean Theorem, with a couple of questions or examples that involve a little bit of algebra. And just in case maybe you're in Algebra 2 and you're seeing some of these Pythagorean Theorem problems where the sides are, say, like x minus 4, not just a simple variable like this with the x. So if you need that, just keep watching, and if not, I'm Mr. Tarrou. Bam! Go do your homework.